Good morning, dear participants. My name is Lumír Hanuš. I am originally from Czechoslovakia and doing research 31 years in Jerusalem at Hebrew University. Let me present my lecture. Unfortunately, they must give me possibility to share screen that you can see the lecture. Future of the research with cannabis and cannabinoids. And cannabis is a very old cultural plant. Of course, we know, everybody today knows what is it cannabis, that it's plant which has male and female plants. And female plants, as you can see, they have something like snow on the leaves. And what is it? These are trichomes, here it's magnification. And if I magnify it even more, so you can see these trichomes. And here is going this miracle in this ball on the top of this trichome. There are originating terpenes, terpenoids, cannabinoid acids. So these are the most important compounds which are such important in treatment of the person. Cannabis, it's nothing new. People use it already long time ago. Probably the oldest information we have from Czech Republic, where American archaeologists found impressions. You can see here, this was some type of weave, which you can see on the right. And because it was not perfect, so they are sure that this was nettle or cannabis. I talked with this, I called to United States, I talked with this archaeologist, they told me it's 50-50. So 50% is possible that this was cannabis. But for sure, the oldest what was found is also in Czech Republic, in Moravia. They found in 7,000 old well, twin. It was like some mud, but in this mud was a very nice twin with threads and two strains. And it was about 7 centimeters long. And this is from hemp. So as you can see, hemp was used long time ago. In China, where this sign means ma, what is female cannabis, so it was used about 6,000 years ago, because we can find in the tombs already like shoes and other textile from cannabis. I just give very brief information from the history. Scythians is very important because Herodotus of Halicarnassus informed us how they use it. They heated stones, and on these stones they threw cannabis seeds. These were also excavated in Siberia. And from the fume, which was above that, they covered themselves with blanket and inhaled it, and they were intoxicated. According to my opinion, these were not seeds, but these were female flowering tops full of seeds, what I show here. That is why they were intoxicated. These compounds, which are very important, these are cannabinoid acids. Not THC, not CBD, these are only cannabinoid acids. The first, the main one is cannabigerolic acid, and from these are three independent acids, cannabidiolic, tetrahydrocannabinolic, and cannabichromic acid. There is no connection between these three acids, and they are three very important acids. What is used today in medicine? These are decarboxylated products, because if we heat these acids, so these carboxyl groups is decarboxylated, and we have, like from tetrahydrocannabinolic acid, we have tetrahydrocannabinol, from cannabidiolic acid, cannabidiol, and this is what is used today. First, who stressed the importance of cannabis as medicine was William O'Shaughnessy, Irish physician, which already in 1843 published in medical journal about Indian hemp, how it's useful in treatment of tetanus and other convulsive diseases. You know that also today it's used again convulsions, so it's known. And also is known John Reynold Russell, which used it for treatment with English Queen or British Queen, which is known, but he was scientist and he published in Archives of Medicine and Lancet, where he stressed that cannabis is very important medicine. First scientific paper which was which tried to identify contents compounds was in 1869, Bolas and Francis, and they isolated compound which they named oxycannabine and some acid compounds. So this was first scientific work. Unfortunately, in 1937 appeared in the United States famous or unfamous Harry Anslinger, which spread false information that cannabis is very dangerous and became prohibition was Marijuana Tax Act from 1937, and cannabis was prohibited and it spread worldwide. Slowly, it became again used as medicine. First, it was used in Czechoslovakia, because in 1950, this was the date when it was rebirth of cannabis use as medicine. Professor Kabelík and Professor Krejčí. Professor Krejčí is with glasses. I am this man with mustache. When I was working, it's from a picture from 1971, when I was working already 1 year. I am working with cannabis 51 years. And Professor Krejčí, he isolated compound which is antibacterially active from cannabis. This was first real cannabinoid which was isolated, and he named it cannabidiolic acid. So Professor Krejčí, very important person, and they found significant antibacterial effects against gram-positive microorganisms, some pathogenic, and they use it in stomatology, otorhinolaryngology, dermatology, gynecology, and other parts of medicine. In Czechoslovakia, it was based on antibacterial effect, so it treated perfect herpes simplex, herpes zoster, or also bed sores, because patients which are long time in the bed, they have bed sores which sometimes go up to the bones. So this was treated very good. This cannabis, which was cultivated in Czechoslovakia, this was so-called fiber cannabis. Cannabis is only one, cannabis sativa linea. It's used in industry, it's used for recreational use, it's used in medicine, but it's the same plant which differs in contents and ratio of the contents compounds. Already in 1954 in at Palacky University in Czechoslovakia was conference Konopí jako lék, cannabis as a medicine, 1954, first scientific conference. And this was in December 1954. And from that time up to 1990, I was in 1990 invited for 1 year to Israel, because Professor Meshulam wanted me to isolate a compound which binds to cannabinoid receptors from the brain. So up to 1990, when I left Czechoslovakia, it was used from 1950 about up to 1990 as medicine. Unfortunately, when I left, it became illegal. So this is structure of cannabidiolic acid, which isolated Professor Krejčí, and with the help of František Šantavý, very famous scientist, they elucidated structure. In 1963, Professor Šantavý sent to the publication work where he elucidated structure and found also absolute configuration of tetrahydrocannabinol, but it's unknown. Known is work of Jechiel Gaoni and Rafael Meshulam. They published it. It appeared out of press also in 1964. And this is tetrahydrocannabinolic acid. In the fact, this first structure was cannabidiol, what isolated Meshulam and also Šantavý independently. But the structure suggested Roger Adams already in 1940, but he didn't know where is this double bond. So structure was elucidated, the problem was only this double bond. And in tetrahydrocannabinol, this structure of tetrahydrocannabinol also elucidated in 1940 Roger Adams in the United States. But the problem was he didn't know where is exactly this double bond. This discovered Professor Šantavý and Jechiel Gaoni and Rafael Meshulam published it in 1964. Professor Šantavý published also absolute configuration. This was not published by these two gentlemen. As soon as was known cannabidiol and tetrahydrocannabinol, so scientists thought that the body is not waiting just when somebody smoke cannabis, and that probably has its own something like cannabis compound which works in the body. And in 1988, Dr. William Devane at St. Louis University discovered CB1 receptor. He called it the central receptor. At that time has 472 acids. This is this yellow one, and this violet is later was discovered CB2. So this was work of William Devane, determination and characterization of cannabinoid receptor in brain. And this is the receptor full all amino acids, how it looks. And Munro discovered CB2 receptor, which was called peripheral receptor. Today it's called CB2 receptor. And if we look how these receptors are expressed in organism, we see that CB1 receptor is mainly in cerebellum, and CB2 receptor is mainly in spleen. But both are at good concentrations. It's islets of Langerhans, so it's clear why it works with diabetes, for instance. And cannabinoid receptors distribution, CB1 receptor is mainly in the brain and in the reproductive system. Reproductive system is very important, how we shall see later when I shall talk about medical use. CB2 receptor is in lymphoid organs and in pancreas and macrophages. Yes, so it's mostly for immunity. And when was discovered receptor, so it was clear that this receptor is not in the body to wait just for smoking cannabis. And at that time, fortunately, in Czechoslovakia terminated socialism and it became democratic. And Professor Meshulam invited me to try to isolate compound from the brain. I thought that I have no chance. Later, when we found that this compound is only in picomoles, so really I was lucky. So I start to work on this compound, and in 1992, after 1.5 years, I isolated anandamide. We did it together with Dr. William Devane. He was specialist in molecular pharmacology. He had receptors, he has the bioassay, how to test compounds. So I isolated and he checked all isolates for activity. And then when I have pure compound and it was very active, we sent it to Roger Pertwee, and Roger Pertwee found that it behaved exactly as cannabinoids. So it was wonderful that THC from cannabis, from higher plant, and anandamide from the brain, that they bind to the same place in the body, to CB1 receptors, and interesting that they bind about with the same activity. So when was known anandamide, so we isolated several other endocannabinoids and became known endocannabinoid system. I have only one picture where all three persons, Dr. William Devane, discoverer of cannabinoid receptors, Shimon Ben Shabbat, Professor Shimon Ben Shabbat, he isolated 2-HG, and me isolated anandamide. Of course, everything was tested by William Devane. He already left when Shimon isolated 2-HG, so Dr. Devane teach me how to do this bioassay, so I already checked 2-HG for activity. Endocannabinoid system, anybody today knows that it's very important because it's important for homeostasis in our body. When we are healthy, body is in balance and we have no problem. As soon as is disbalance, it means disease, so body do its best to treat itself, and endocannabinoid system start to work. If a person is not enough strong, so we must add treatment, some medicine, and today it is cannabis what works with cannabinoid receptors. So endocannabinoid system, as I mentioned, these are CB1 and CB2 receptors, endocannabinoids, and of course enzyme which synthesize these endocannabinoids, and enzymes which degrade these endocannabinoids. For your information, whole problem is not such easy because we have CB1 and CB2 receptor. In parentheses, every time is written how many amino acids consists each receptor. So these are not only cannabinoid receptors, but as you can see, these are also GPR receptors, PPAR receptor, TRPV receptors, and others. I couldn't write all of them. So it's combination of many receptors which work together just to keep body in homeostasis. So cannabis, as you can see, is wonderful medicine, but I every time stress 4-no, and keep in mind that it's wonderful medicine, but it's not panaceum. So it doesn't treat every time, it doesn't treat everyone, it doesn't treat every disease, and it doesn't treat every stage of disease. Soon I will show you that it's not such easy and that we must be in the treatment very careful. Concerning treatment, of course, it's big effort to synthesize semi-synthetic derivatives of these cannabinoids, which will be more efficient and also more expensive because pharmaceutical industry wants money from that. This is the main. It's not like that the main is treat patient. The main is that patient use medicine. And excuse me, but I must tell this for pharmaceutical industry, is not the best patient which is treated with medicine. The best is the patient which is chronic patient, which must use whole life medicine, because this is whole life profit for pharmaceutical companies, unfortunately. So when we treat patients, we must be very careful, and today they try to prepare different derivatives. But today, principally, is used only Sativex, what is a mixture of isolated tetrahydrocannabinol and cannabidiol, dronabinol. What is dronabinol, marinol? This is syndros. This is tetrahydrocannabinol. And then we have Epidiolex. This is isolated cannabidiol. Of course, if it's written cannabinoid, it will be cheaper. When it's Epidiolex, so you must pay for that. So everything is built on the money, unfortunately. Patient is, I had lectures in 30 countries. And when I talk with people, I thought patients is not on the first place, unfortunately. The only semi-synthetic is nabilone compound, its derivative, dimethylheptyl derivative of THC, and it's oxidated. And this treats only nausea and vomiting. Very often, today they talk about entourage effect of cannabis, because they start to talk about terpenes, terpenoids, and that these are also very important, and they are talking about entourage effect. But we don't know if it's synergic effects or independent effect of the compounds or entourage effect, because synergic, I express this with this equation. 1 + 1 = 2. If it's active compound and another active, so together they are more than two active. An entourage effect, which originally published Professor Shimon Ben Shabbat with Professor Meshulam in 1998. So it means that we have active compound and inactive compound, so it's more active than active compound. What I express this with an equation, 1 + 0 = 1. So you must understand this, that still, even when we use entourage effect, that sometimes it can be synergic effect. Cannabis, I want to stress also that cannabis, even when you use it long time, is not harmful, but to a mentally healthy adult person. Mentally healthy adult person, there is no danger. There is only one danger, and it can be overdose, because overdosing is not harmful, however it is very uncomfortable. Even recreational users, when they use more than is necessary and they are overdosed, so these recreational users never use cannabis again. So when we treat patients, that is why, to prevent overdosing. So general principle in treatment is start low and go slow. You start patient with very small amounts of cannabis, and slowly you go up to the level when patient feels the effect of cannabis. This is very important. Unfortunately, recreational user buy cannabis on black market and doesn't know if it is strong or weak, and sometimes they are really overdosed. So it's very important, and as I said, if it's entourage or synergic effect, so better than pure cannabinoids, which what I mentioned, Sativex, Dronabinol, Epidiolex, so better are just preparations from pure cannabinoids with terpenes, simply extract, because there are all the compounds which are important to treat patients. And this we must learn how I show you in the next. So also it's very important when we treat patients to identify also patients which can lose from use cannabis, because it's wonderful medicine, but it's not for everybody. So we must find also such patients to prevent them not to feel bad after cannabis use. I now shall mention several uses of cannabis. Cannabis is wonderful compound against cancer, because one of the benefits of cannabinoids is they fight specifically against cancer cells and without any toxic effect and without harming normal cells. So it is very important, and I show you study of Professor Meiri from Technion from Haifa. He studied anti-cancer effect of cannabis. What he used? He used breast cancer cells, colon cancer cells, prostate cells, and non-cancer cells. And then he used three different strains of cannabis. When he used first strain, it beat breast cancer cells. If he used second strain, it beats cancer cells. Third was not against this cancer. Colon cancer, the same, these three strains, yes? Again, first and second help, and third didn't help. Concerning prostate, first strain didn't help, second strain didn't help, and third strain helped. And non-cancer cells, of course, no, this cell was harmed because it's very safe for healthy cells. And what now happened? In these three strains, the main compounds were THC, CBD, cannabigerol, CBG, cannabichroban, CBC, and cannabinol. And now, as you can see, these three were low CBD, high THC, and second be low THC, high CBD, low THC, high CBD. As you can see, second and third were the same concerning contents of CBD and THC. But as you can see, one time it treated, one time not, one time treated, one time not, and concerning prostate cancer, it was just opposite. What does it mean? It means that we cannot talk about CBD and THC. There are also other important compounds which are very important to cooperate with CBD and THC. This can be terpenes, this can be terpenoids, this can be flavonoids, this can be flavonoid glycosides, polyphenols, and other bioactive compounds. So this I mentioned, and I would like now to tell you about treatment with industrial hemp, because industrial hemp, everybody think, this is industrial hemp, it's not interesting. But I want to stress that in Czechoslovakia we treated with industrial hemp. There is high CBD, low THC. Of course, this THC is lower than 0.3% what is in the fact legal, but it was not problem because we could use also if it was over. But we found that this hemp can treat very good. And one company in the Prague, Canacare, they are using just technical or industrial cannabis. For me, cannabis is cannabis. Yes, these are only people named it technical, medicinal, recreational, but it's still the same plant. So they treated, they treated a cancer. What happened now? Excuse me. They treated woman with hemp. She had cancer, grade 3, stage 4. What means that it already are metastasis just up to the spine. And conventional therapy was rejected. So in 7.5 months after use of cannabis, this lady was healthy. They treat her with French hemp Hemotrypsantica, which is rich in CBG, and Hemotype Fedora 17, which is rich in CBD. It means in the morning CBG, in the evening CBD, and opposite, and 7.5 months she was healthy. Now I would like to tell you story about one man. He came to me that his wife has cancer. She had about 4 months old daughter, and she had also the last stage of her cancer of the breast, and tumor was 4.9 centimeters, almost 5 centimeters big. I arranged her contact with Prague, and she used this cannabis in 1.5 months. In 1.5 months, this tumor disappeared. Physician told her, I don't know how you treated it, but continue with this treatment, it's wonderful, because she didn't want chemotherapy or radio. So she was fully treated. But what happened? Came COVID. COVID, also dangerous disease. She didn't have COVID, but because of COVID, she didn't have another amount of this cannabis, and because she couldn't use it, so she had from physician cannabis, so she could use cannabis, but different one with high THC. It didn't help her. So everything returned, and she had cancer back. And it is known, I won't stress it, how it's important the strain. It's not only on the percentage of some cannabinoids. Important is the strain, because it is known also that not everybody can treat cancer, and not every cancer, but patients which treated cancer fully, it means that they don't have cancer cells. So it was found that if they stop immediately using cannabis, it returns. So they should continue with cannabis to take lower level to keep just body cells healthy. So it is very important, and this is wonderful medicine, but it is not such easy. We must still work on that and know how to treat patient with which strain, how much and how, because somebody suggests you can only vaporize it, but sometimes you can swallow it with capsules, plant material or extract, or you can use spray under tongue, or you can use suppositories. It's very effective, because suppository, even if it's a higher concentration of THC, so there is not first metabolization, because if you use it per os, so it metabolizes to 11-hydroxy-THC, which is more psychoactive than THC. It is not per rectum. So it's important also how to use it. Sometimes it's better this way, sometimes the other one. So we must be very careful. Now, with this technical cannabis or industrial cannabis, they in CannaCare continued also treating burns which they couldn't heal. So as you can see, day zero burns of the patient, it looks really not nice, and after 24 hours with cannabis which was used topically, as you can see, it looks better. After 48 hours, even it's 2 days, it's wonderful how it works. In 4 days, it looks really good. And after 9 days, you see that these burns are principally treated. So don't think that only cannabis with high THC, what is spread around the internet and anywhere. Also, technical cannabis can do work, and it will be without this problem that police can stop you, that you treated yourself with cannabis, because this is, in many countries, it's legal cannabis, so it's no problem. And also very important is treatment of autism in children. This also passed Dr. Bayeri at Technion in Haifa, so I won't share his information. You know, autistic children, it's not like that we have small problems. Some autistic children are very aggressive, and some of them must be in hospital, and they are tied to the bed, not to harm others, and not to harm themselves, because they can damage their eyes with fingers, so they must be tied. And they tried to treat them. As you can see, after use of cannabis was really improvement concerning attack on others, aggressive behavior, self-injuries, restlessness, yes? And as you can see, for males it was better than for females. Like habits, 53% males improve, no female. Repetitive movement, you know, they have a stereotype that they move all the time, for instance, with leg, yard, hand, or head, yes. So again, males 48% success, only 9% females. Eye contact, because they don't contact you with eyes. So also improvement was 47%, and females, it was not such successful. And response to name, when you call them with the name, so it was improved 50% of these males react, not women. Women, it's more complicated, because when we treat women, it's also important at which stage of the month, at which stage of the period, which is comes periodically. Yes, when it's on the top or on the low, so it's everything influence treatment of women. So it's more complicated. This we must understand. So these autistic children, they use cannabis strain which has CBD THC 20:1. So it means 20% CBD. And only 1% THC. It was wonderful. These children, which were tied because they can endanger themselves, so physicians sent them back home. They said, we have no reason to keep them in hospital because they are polite and there is no problem with them. It treated them, yes? And if we look, so here are of this strain, cannabinoids, and as you can see, very strong below tetrahydrocannabinolic acid and cannabidiolic acid. So it means CBD, THC. When just plant this cannabis, it takes about 3 months, and when they spend all material, so they gave to children different strain. This was strain again 20:1, 20% CBD, 1% THC. And what happened? Several children, they returned to hospital. They were aggressive or harmed themselves. So I don't want just talk about what happened, but it was attack mother or jumped through glass door and so on. So they check cannabis, and they found, as you can see, dark is highest concentration, white is lowest concentration of different cannabinoids. They check only cannabinoids. As you can see, again, cannabidiolic acid and tetrahydrocannabinolic acid were strong, but THCA, it was 1%, yes, CBD, it was 20%. It was the same, but very different other compounds. And as soon as they cultivated in 3 months the strain which helped to these children, so they were again okay. So it's very important. Unfortunately, for instance, in Israel, they decided that it will not be again strain, that it will be only again percentage of THC and CBD. And patients are disappointed because he comes to take strains, to take plant material, and one time it helps, one time it doesn't help, because it can be different strain even when are the same percentage of THC and CBD. So, as you can see, what I said, THCA 1% and CBDA was the same in these two strains, but other compounds, and this we are talking here only about cannabinoids, but of course very important can differ terpenes, terpenoids, and other compounds. So it is very important just to keep child healthy or autist healthy. I was with Hebrew University, and now I am working with, because I retired, with Asana Bio Group. They have two labs, Lumir Lab and Gynica. Lumir Lab, this just work with identifications of cannabinoids, cannabinoid acids, terpenes, terpenoids, just the compounds. And Gynica just can use and try compounds and their combination, how it helps. And we are concentrated today on endometriosis. Endometriosis is very serious disease because at present time about 10% world population of women have endometriosis. Some women don't know that they have endometriosis, but they have problems because period is long time, is very painful. This woman cannot give birth to the child, and are many problems with that. And if we look on uterus and on ovary, so if we check how it's with cannabinoid receptors and cannabinoids, we can see that in uterus is CB1 receptors and PPAR receptors. In ovary, there is CB1 and CB2 receptors, PPAR receptors and fatty acid aminohydrolase. So there are also anandamide and 2-AG. So you can see that cannabis can be very important in treatment of endometriosis, what we are working on. And also Israel physicians, which treated women with cannabis, so they had very, very good results. I know one physician, and he treated a woman with endometriosis fully, that she was just okay. You know, and endometriosis is another problem, because later it can turn to endometrial cancer. And when she has endometrial cancer, so plasma anandamide and palmitoyl ethanolamide levels are significantly elevated. What it means? It means that endocannabinoid system started to work and do its best to treat this woman, but not every time is successful. Sometimes you can have cancer and you never know that you had cancer because your organism can beat it, but not every time. It depends how strong are you. And also when it's cancer, so there is not only in uterus CB1, as I mentioned, but goes up CB1 and goes up also CB2 and 2-arachidonoyl glycerol, 2-AG. And also when we look on ovarian cancer, for instance, so we can see that in ovaries is GPR55 receptors, TRPV6 receptor. I showed you that there are many receptors, so these are some of them. And monoacylglycerol lipase. Yes, so this goes up, so it means that if it's ovarian cancer, that also body do the best to fight. And also, as I said, also not only CB1, CB2 is expressed, but also TRPV1, what is amyloid receptor in the fact. We tried to do our best as fast as possible, but it doesn't go fast. I talk about that already, but we must know what to treat endometriosis. By what? We want to treat with cannabis. So then comes in vitro. This is part of Gynica. Yes, here is part of Lumirla. And then in vivo study on animals and clinical studies. And now formulations and delivery, because the result must be cannabinoid vaginal suppositories, because suppositories, they can act directly because in uterus are cannabinoid receptors. And also vaginal lubricant, very important, which is non-psychoactive and which can help women. But still, we must work on that a lot, because our goal is minimum compounds from the plant with maximum effect. As I didn't stress when I talk about diseases, that these physicians in Haifa, they tried to treat one disease and they came to three cannabinoids. And when there are only two, it didn't help. When there are three, it helped. So it must be combination of cannabinoids, cannabinoid acids, because today are popular acids. You know, before in Israel, when it started medicinal cannabis, they were interested only in THC. And I told them in Czechoslovakia, it was based on CBD and CBDA. Then they came that they want CBD, and I told them, you need cannabinoid acids. So today they found also that cannabinoid acids are wonderful, because in Czechoslovakia we didn't decarboxylate it. We used just full extract as it was with acids. So this is our target, to find the most important compound that it can help to the most women, because not all of them will be treated, but can be treated most of them. If it will be curative, it means that they stay, or if it will be palliative, but this palliative, as I said, with cancer, they must keep body healthy, that they use just small amount of cannabis. It is very important. Because if I show you how it looks today, this cannabis, so you can see that today were identified 1,948 compounds in cannabis, and cannabinoids already are known 289. I think last time I gave 100 less, 289. And these are typical for this plant and doesn't occur in any other plant, and 1,659 are other identified substances. So now we must have combination which are important from this 289 and which from 1,659 together, which are important to be efficient medicine. Now, of course, we have so many, almost 300 cannabinoids, but I am sure, because first, cannabis is on sun, so UV works, that there can be already, when on leaves are these trichomes, they are not living when they are ripe, so it stays and it can change during UV sunlight. When they harvest plant and dry it, storage is processing, and even during analysis in instrument, it can be changed that I don't see exactly what is really in the plant. So this, everything you must take in consideration. So it's very important, as you can see, it's wonderful medicine, but it's not panacea, and it's a lot of work. In the fact, it looks like that. We know about cannabinoids, and mostly we don't know about terpenes, terpenoids, flavonoids, flavonoid glycosides, polyphenols, steroids, and other compounds, and then still, all these compounds, of course, you cannot find in one plant. These are from different strains of cannabis, different cultivars. And this is the most important to find it. So I hope that we will be successful. I don't mean our lab, but I think like we humans worldwide, that we will be successful to use cannabis for good, and that it will help as it is supposed to help to the humans. Thank you very much for your attention.
Estamos usando compuestos de CBD y THC 20 en 1 para autismo, y nosotros queríamos preguntarle el tema de los rangos de edad, porque estamos haciendo los diagnósticos en chicos menores de un año, y la verdad no estamos tan seguros del uso de CBD y THC rango de 20 en 1 en chicos tan chicos.
Okay, she is asking you, Lumir, about the age of the children with autism. She says she is not sure to use about in the range of 21.
What she want to know about children?
About the range of the age, of the age. The age of the children age. And, and the relationship.
Is there a small children? These are... usually below teenage age.
And the proportion of THC and CBD?
As I said, it was 20 to 1, but the most important was the strain, because if they check only proportion of CBD and THC, one time it helped, one time it didn't help. So, but up to now, it was not found which other compounds are important. And this is the target, because as I said, not only in our lab, also in other labs, they will minimize minimum compound and maximum effect. This is the most important.
Sí, él dice que bueno, que este, el rango etario es para niños pequeños hasta adolescentes, que respecto a las proporciones, en algunas ocasiones funciona, en algunas otras ocasiones no funciona, pero que por esa es la razón por la cual siempre se recomienda utilizar cantidades pequeñas, iniciar con bajas dosis y mantenerse con dosis bajas, e ir evaluando constantemente el resultado clínico.
Muchas gracias, sí, eso es lo que estamos haciendo. O sea, personalizar el tratamiento en cada chico y en conjunto con la mamá. Entonces, así es de a uno y ver cómo van, digamos. Pero queríamos más o menos tener la idea de la edad en la que lo podemos comenzar a usar. Bueno, gracias.
I would like to tell you something about endocannabinoids. When was discovered cortisone, 1935. Next year, it was wonderful medicine. When was discovered insulin, 1922, I think, or 1921. Next year, it was wonderful medicine. We isolated anandamide in 1992. It's unbelievable that after 30 years, still it was not used by human. So unfortunately, there are no experiments. I don't understand why there are no experiments, because there are probably so many obstacles that many persons, they don't want to work with cannabis. Today, situation, because it's popular, so situation is easier. But still, it's not on the level which is necessary to be. I think concerning cannabinoids, in the near future, we must find which compounds are important, not only cannabinoids, but also other compounds, because effort was done concerning derivatives of cannabinoids, and as you know, all derivatives or compounds which they called cannabinoids. Unfortunately, you can read that some cannabinoids are very dangerous, but these compounds are not cannabinoids. These are compounds which can bind to cannabinoid receptors, but this compound have nothing with cannabis, and even structure is not similar to cannabis. But when reader which doesn't know anything about that read that cannabinoids are dangerous, and in the fact they are talking about compounds which are not cannabinoids, so then they are afraid of cannabis. I think on the level they go slow, simply start with very low amounts and slowly increase it, there is no danger, of course. Of course, in some patients we must be very careful because, as I said, it's very safe for mentally healthy person, and it's very safe also for adults, because I didn't talk here about children and about teenagers. This is the biggest problem. I was also young, and as children we try to smoke, we try to use alcohol, but it's the worst. If somebody wants to try cannabis, I tell them, try it after age 25. You are on the safe side. Don't try it when you are young, because you harm your organism. If it's alcohol, cigarettes or cannabis, any compound which is psychoactive. So try it when you are adult and when you are mentally healthy. Because sometimes, of course, can be danger that in some person is sleeping some mental disease, and he can provoke it with the use of cannabis. So we must be very careful, and that is why it can be safe from the hands of a physician. And even if cannabis will be fully legalized, so even recreational users, they should use only official cannabis, that they know what is in and how much they can use, because otherwise they endanger themselves if they buy it on black market.
Good morning. My name is Fernanda. First, I have to say I'm a little bit shy to ask, but I think it is very important that you are speaking with us. So thank you very much. Thank you very much for your presentation. And I would like to know, this is a question about something different of what is your area of expertise, which is your scientific study of cannabinoids. But I would like to ask you, what do you think, or what in your experience, what have you seen or studied about, let's say, the difference between you said that the industrial pharmaceutical is equal as the one which is not industrial. So, because you said cannabinoids, cannabis is cannabis. My question is, in your experience, what have you seen about, especially, plaguicides, pesticides, agrotoxics? I mean, in your study of many years, I guess in Czechoslovakia, the one you said, you have seen many of these. And I would like to know, because I know these industries, for example, discharge a lot amount of discharge of water effluents. So, most of them are contaminated. So in your experience, what have you seen about, especially about environmental law, to say that today we are in a state to say that the cannabis, industrial cannabis, is equal to organic cannabis? Thank you so much.
If I mean medical cannabis, recreational or industrial, of course it doesn't mean that you go to the field where is industrial hemp and you can harvest several plants for your use. Of course, even this type of cannabis. It means we call it industrial, but it's cannabis, this low amount of cannabinoids must be cultivated proprietary. We cultivated it in agricultural institute on the soil, which was known that there are not used pesticides, herbicides, that there are no heavy metals, because cannabis is known, if you want clean soil from heavy metals, just plant cannabis. Cannabis takes these heavy metals from the soil, so you must be very careful concerning planting, and that is why also in Israel they don't plant it just in the ground, they just use it above, yes, above level of ground, of course, where they cultivate it in special soil, which is clean of anything, no heavy metals, no pesticides, nothing, and they use it just one time, and then they bring new one for another, because otherwise cannabis is known that that field where you cultivate is not tired from that, like from some other plants. You can cultivate cannabis on the same spot all the time, but if it will be inappropriate soil, so also cannabis can be not suitable for medical use. So it's very important where to cultivate it and what is the soil. So this I thought also this industrial, not just that they cultivated like corn or flour, yes, and it must be correct soil, because we want it, even if it will be legalized, so we want it of medicinal level, this cannabis, that it doesn't harm person.
Hannes, thank you very much for being with us. It's an honor to have you, and thank you very much. We hope you will be here also for our next conference.
Thank you very much. I wish you success in your effort, if it's research or if it's treatment, that treatment is successful, that patients are satisfied, and that it can help them with any harm. Thank you, and I wish good success for your conference, and that also impact will be as it's supposed to be. Thank you.